Monday, November the 16th, 2015 at 2 p.m. in council chambers. So we're going to look at some adoption of minutes first. The committee of the whole meeting minutes of November the 2nd, 2015, and the regular open minutes of November the 2nd, 2015, and those will both be adopted by consensus. I don't believe there's any business arising from the minutes, no. And is there introduction of late items? No. Okay, just two things that I wanted to say. First is welcome to Brianne Hilson, who is our new deputy corporate officer, and she is in training at the moment and will take over from Lori Scott, who is retiring at the end of December. So welcome to you both here today. And the other thing is that this morning at our Committee of the Whole meeting, we thought we were on Granicus, and actually you will see the pictures of us all on Granicus, but there was no sound, and we apologize for that. So it has been fixed for this afternoon, but there was no sound on that this morning, anybody watching or looking at it online. No delegations, and the first thing that we have is some water matters. And their water district cash requirements to November the 16th are in the amount of $40,391.14 for council approval. Okay, that would be Water Councillor Marrera. Seconded, Water Councillor Ray. All in favor? Thank you. And next is the correspondence, and there is a Okanagan Basin Water Board meeting. I'm just going to talk about one of the items on there, and that is the Okanagan Drought Plan, and that will be further discussed. It was discussed at the last OBWB meeting, and we're going to have a good look at that because we think it should be something that is coordinated throughout the valley. So you will hear more about this. Anybody else have anything to add? Okay, so we will accept that, that correspondence from OBWB. Bylaws, public washroom caretaker and town facilities. And is that Mr. Mankel?
Thank you, Mayor McCordoff. For the past several years, the town has had separate contracts for the public washroom cleaning and the town building janitorial. Earlier this year, both contracts were put out for a quick tender due to unexpected endings to the contracts. At the time, both were tendered for short periods of time, being the public washroom caretaker from August 1st, 2015 to December 31st, 2015, and town building maintenance from July 1st, 2015 to July 1st, 2016. Evergreen maintenance, building maintenance was the successful bidder on both contracts. Staff has reviewed both contracts and has come to the conclusion that it would be beneficial for the town and any contractor to continue to have the same contractor provide the services for both contracts rather than having two separate contracts. Since the town building maintenance contract ends July 1st, it is being requested that council approve the attached contract modification agreement with Evergreen Building Maintenance to extend the public washroom contract to July 1st, 2016. It is also being requested that council direct staff to prepare a tender for one contract, being town and public facilities custodian, in spring of 2016. The new contract would cover the following buildings: Town Hall, Fire Hall, Destination Associates, Planning and Development, Public Works, Gyro and Goodman washrooms year-round, all other public washrooms from April 16th to October 15th each year. In terms of implications, community, cleanliness of public facilities. Organizationally, there's time to monitor the contracts and prepare the tender documents. No budget implications at this time over and above the current cost. Significant dates, the modification agreement should be approved prior to year-end in order that Evergreen Building Maintenance can ensure staffing availability. Sustainability, continue to provide clean facilities. Three options are being presented to council today. The council approved the contract modification agreement to extend the public washroom caretaker contract with Evergreen Maintenance to July 1st, 2016, and that staff be directed to prepare a tender for spring 2016 for a contract for the town building janitorial and the public washroom cleanings. Second, that the contract modification agreement not be approved and the staff tender the public washroom caretaking contract immediately. And number three, that this matter be reviewed further. Staff is recommending option number one. Evergreen building maintenance has provided good service to this point, and by extending the public washroom contract to July 1st, 2016 will give staff time to prepare a single tender document to include both public washrooms and the town building janitorial.
Thank you very much. Council, what is your wish? Councillor Rhodes.
Thank you, Mayor McCordoff. I'll move option number one.
Thank you. And Councillor Campbell, that's seconding it. Does anybody need to talk to that? It sounds like it's very straightforward and a sensible way to handle it. All in favor? Thank you. That's carried. Next is the incident reporting policy. Mr. Davis.
Thank you, Madam Mayor, Council. Bill 9 was formally adopted as part of the Workers' Compensation Act, and it relates to how employers conduct incident investigations. Because of this new legislation, our OH&S contractor, McMullen Company, has created a draft policy and a draft incident report form. Reporting incidents include everything from serious injury to near misses, with the intention of being proactive to prevent future incidents and create a safer work environment. Once Bill 9 was formally adopted, McMullen started this process with the Joint Occupational Health and Safety Committee by conducting crew talks. The crew talks were delivered to staff as general information, and as a follow-up to the crew talks, he developed draft documents. McMullen created a policy statement and a number of report forms that cover all aspects of the new legislation. Staff has shared these draft documents with the management group and also with the Joint OH&S Committee. As part of this report, I've attached an overview from WorkSafe BC that outlines the steps to conduct an incident investigation along with the draft policy statement and forms. In terms of implications for the community, creating a safe working environment also creates a safer community. Organizational implications, directors will be expected to deliver crew talks to all staff and make sure they are aware of the new incident reporting policy. Significant dates. This bill was passed in May of 2015. There was some grace then extended, but this should be implemented ASAP. In terms of sustainability, creating a safe work environment, being proactive to prevent injuries helps sustain our workforce at optimal levels. Three options being presented for council to adopt this draft document as the incident reporting policy and utilize the attached forms as part of that policy. Option number two, for council to instruct staff to create a different incident reporting policy. Or option number three, not to do anything at this time, status quo. And staff is recommending option number one. McMullen has created a policy statement and report forms that has covered everything that is required by WorkSafe BC in the new legislation. They have extensive knowledge in this area, and they have created similar documents for other municipalities.
Thank you, Mr. Davis. Can I just ask, Mr. Davis is sporting a patch on one eye, and we're just hoping that it has nothing to do with incident reporting policy. That did not cause us to have to renew this policy, did it?
No.
No, it didn't. Good. Can I just ask, is this something that is updated on a 5 years or 10 years, or was there something that precipitated this update?
I think according to McMullen, there was a major incident in the province that directly related to this being improved,
okay.
And that's why this is coming forward. And it was back in April, I believe, or even earlier, that something happened.
So my assumption is this is being done in most municipalities right now.
That is correct.
Okay. Councillor Campbell.
I would move for council to adopt this draft document as the incident reporting policy and utilize the attached forms as part of that policy.
Thank you. Councillor Youngberg, are you seconding that? Mm-hmm. Is there anyone else that would like to have any questions about that? All in favor? Thank you very much. That's carried. Thank you, Mr. Davis. And next is our Community Services Advisory Committee Terms of Reference. Mr. Davis.
Thank you, Madam Mayor, Council. The Parks and Recreation Commission has been established under bylaw 940, and it involves the town of Osoyoos and the regional district of Okanagan-Similkameen Area A. This bylaw is outdated, and as per the recommendations of our community services master plan, we need to develop a new community services model. As part of the new structure, this committee will aid in the development of the BC Age Friendly program and will also be the advisory group to oversee the Healthy Living Coalition in our area. Bylaw 940 was established to coordinate the recreation activities related to the town of Osoyoos and Area A. It has always been a great sounding board for local residents to bring forward new initiatives and ideas. Since the department has taken on a greater role in terms of community services, we need to rescind the bylaw and bring forward a new terms of reference. The new terms of reference will address recreational and environmental needs, the age-friendly program, and the Healthy Living Coalition Protocol. It also includes representatives that will represent the RDOS, the Town of Osoyoos, School District 53. Within the new terms of reference, we also want to add a member from Interior Health and a youth representative. This will help us achieve the elements we have included in our new community services model. Rather than make amendments to the existing bylaw, staff has created a new terms of reference and requests that council repeal bylaw 940 and all amendments thereto. Staff has presented this draft terms of reference to the current Recreation Commission, and they had no objections to the format or contents. Staff had discussed the existing structure with the RDOS, and it was agreed that we do not need this committee established under a bylaw. A standing committee of council would be the best option. Attached are the new draft terms of reference and consolidated bylaw 940 with its amendments. In terms of implications for the community, establishing a committee to address our recreational and sustainable needs in the community is an excellent opportunity to get direct feedback and new ideas as we move forward. And part of organizational, staff is part of the organization and administration of this committee, whereby we set the agendas and bring forward any initiatives brought forward from the committee. The budget, there is no budget dollars required for this committee. We would like to do this ASAP. And in terms of sustainability, the committee will oversee and make recommendations that will be related to the goals outlined in the community sustainability plan, See Osoyoos Succeed. Options, number one, repeal bylaw 940 and all amendments thereto, and approve the new terms of reference for our community services advisory committee. Option number two, repeal bylaw 940 and all amendments thereto, and do not accept the new terms of reference. And option number three, no changes at this time, status quo. Administration recommends option number one, having a contemporary terms of reference better reflects the needs of the community and provides better direction to the committee. Having this terms of reference will enable the town to meet the criteria of the age-friendly BC program and apply for future funding. If council approves this recommendation, it will also have to go to the RDOS board for approval.
Thank you. Would the members of the committee, as they sit presently, would they be automatic members of the new committee? Or is there, like, you've just approved some of them recently, haven't you?
That's so correct. What I would plan to do is bring back that as a recommendation to adopt the three current members, as long as they're okay with that, which I think they are. And I also believe we would have to create a new bylaw to rescind bylaw number 940.
Is that what we're...
I think I will bring that back the next meeting. I will bring that back the next meeting.
Okay, and it looks like, and approve the new terms of reference. So
it is the new terms of reference.
Yeah.
Yes, that's correct. Yeah.
Okay, so Mr. Romanko, does that make sense that if this was to go through, it would be, we would repeal one and okay the other, and that would do it all in one fell swoop?
That's right. So this is bylaw 940
okay.
here. So repealing this bylaw and then replacing it with the terms of reference, and then Gerald would bring back the committee members for approval, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So, Councillor King.
Yeah, I'd make a resolution that we adopt number one, repeal bylaw number 940 and all amendments thereto, and approve the new terms of reference for the Community Service Advisory Committee. And as a member of that committee, we did all have a chance to review this document, and we're very satisfied with it.
Okay. Thank you. Is there somebody? Thank you. Councillor Youngberg has seconded that. Anyone else like to speak to it? All in favor? Thank you very much for doing that. I think that's a good way to go.
Thank you very much.
Establishing a local conservation fund, Mr. Romanko.
Thank you, Mayor McCordoff. At the Council's November 2nd Committee of the Whole meeting, Bryn White from the South Okanagan Similkameen Conservation Program provided Council with an overview of the process and advantages of setting up a local conservation fund. A conservation fund is a dedicated fund source established by the regional district or municipality to support environmental conservation. The fund provides local financial support for activities to protect valuable natural areas and as part of restoring and sustaining a healthy local environment. It focuses on projects that don't fall within the mandate of other levels of government. A regional district or municipality has the legal authority to establish and operate a conservation fund as a service, just as other services such as fire protection, water supply, recreation, and waste management. The fund can be financed through a property tax, parcel tax, local area service tax, or management fees. A fund program usually runs for 10 years, after which the municipality or regional district decides whether or not it will continue. Five BC regional districts have created conservation funds, four of which are comparable to the regional district, and they are mostly rural, the East and Central Kootenay RDs, Central Okanagan and Cowichan Valley districts, as well as the Capital Region District. As a result of the presentation, the following resolution was passed, moved by Councillor Youngberg and seconded by Councillor King. Resolved that administration be requested to bring a report to Council at the November 16th regular meeting for discussion and budget consideration. Soyuz has recognized the need to be environmentally conscious in both the Integrated Community Sustainability Plan and the Official Community Plan. In the ICSP, the attached page 19 identifies a 2030 vision for land use and natural areas that can be used to guide the use of the Conservation Fund. There's also an immense number of the other references to the environmental sensitivity of the area, protection of species at risk, and importance of lake health to the overall economic and social sustainability. Section 5.7.3 of the OCP identifies the environmental opportunities in the event that community boundaries are expanded to the Cougar Mountain area, and other projects will be identified based on our current trails and master plan processes. The development of a conservation fund can take at least four obvious forms. One, a community fund that is self-funded from Soyuz tax funds, and only projects in town boundaries are considered for funding. Two, a community fund that is self-funded from Soyuz tax funds, and projects in town boundaries and other areas are considered for funding. Three, the regional district sets up a regional service that Soyuz pays into based on assessment or household basis, and projects in town and or of regional significance are considered for support. And four, Council agrees to be part of the regional district program and also develops a local conservation fund. Options number one and number two have significant local control of funds and project selection. Option number three would see a regional decision-making system that may see lesser amounts of local control. In terms of implications, the community, a Soyuz location lends itself to motivating residents and visitors to have a high degree of environmental consciousness. Public tax contributions into a conservation fund would provide funding for projects that would facilitate the promotion of an environmental conscience. Organizationally, an organizational liaison between a conservation board and town operations would need it to be implemented. If a public engagement process would be considered, it would be led by the planning department and with assistance of the South Okanagan Similkameen Conservation Program. Budget. Council would have to identify the priority amount of funding that would be acceptable either to either a local or regional conservation fund. The funds would either come from reallocating existing program expenditures or additional taxation for specific fund. Options for funding include, number one, designated per household charge, for example, $10 per household. Two, an identified amount of needed funding, and this amount is added to the annual tax requisition. In terms of dates,
The South Okanagan Smilk Mean Conservation Program will be working with the regional district communities in 2016 to determine if this project goes forward. If council sees the need to fund this project in 2016, a budget allocation will be needed in the 2016 budget process. In terms of sustainability, establishing a fund of this nature will assist in achieving the Integrated Community Sustainability Plan vision for 2030. Four options are being presented to council today. One, council provides direction to include a public engagement process in the 2016 business plan to assess public support for the development of a local or regional supported conservation fund. A decision on supporting a conservation fund and the method to be employed would be considered after a review of the public input. Two, council provides direction to identify a household allocation or total budget figure that will be put into the 2016 budget process for debate and decision. At some point in time, council will require a decision on one of the four delivery formats identified earlier or some other format. Number three, council provides direction not to pursue developing a conservation fund until action is taken by the regional district to develop a regional service. Council or the regional district board representatives would provide direction to the regional district board that a public engagement process be led by the regional district to gauge public acceptance of a conservation fund. And four, council requests additional information. The recommendation, administration recommends option number one. The development of a conservation fund is within the mandate of municipal council. However, a conservation fund is a new service area. The administration recommends that the public be given the opportunity to provide input on the importance of the service and the method of delivery.
Thank you very much. This is a bit of a tricky issue, I think. I've read it a couple times, and I was even at the RDOS meeting where, you know, it has been discussed before. Because there is some fairly significant money implications in this, such as $20 a household, or I think that was thrown around, I certainly do agree that that there needs to be further consultation with town people to have a look at this. I know that the group that was here, Bryn, would certainly like it to be a regional service, and so that would be the other thing we'd need to decide, whether it was important to have it as a local service or a regional service. So anybody on council like to? Councillor Rhodes.
Thank you, Mayor McCordoff. One of the advantages to hearing all of the details prior to have to making a decision on this, you know, these last couple of weeks has given me lots of opportunity to think about it. And I'm going to put a motion out to support option number one, exactly how it's worded. And if we get a second, I'd like to speak to that.
Sure. Thank you. Councillor King seconded that. So, Councillor Rhodes, would you like to speak to it?
My reasons for going that route, and I know it's not exactly, you know, what this organization would really like us to do. There was a pretty strong pitch to support the regional district one, but I don't want to speak in disfavor of any of the regional district things, but I think we would get better bang for the money that we put into it by following the recommendation and the wording in number one. The regional district process could choose projects that have no bearing in our community. I'm not saying that they would, but certainly we would miss out on some of those opportunities, and that's why I feel quite strongly about keeping it within our community and our budget.
Thank you. Anybody else like to speak to it? Yes, Councillor Member.
I agree with Councillor CJ that I think we should get a little more information, and we should really allow the public to be involved in this. I think it's a big decision to make when you're talking about taxing each household. So I look forward to participating in that.
And I believe from the wording of this recommendation that the public would also get the option of saying whether it should be a local service or regional. So we could ask that question as well. Okay, anybody else? No. So all in favor of the motion for option one. Thank you very much. That was easy.
Yeah.
And I didn't forget your name.
Oh, okay.
Oh, okay. Oh, it is over on this side. Okay.
We never do this.
So we do not have any notices of motion. That would be next on the list. Okay, and so we're going to go to cash requirements. And there's a report from our payroll clerk that general Sunbowl cash, general Sunbowl Arena cash requirements and net net payroll accounts to November the 16th, representing balances in the following funds in the amount of general cash, $90,060.23, and Sunbowl cash requirements of $1,058.49. And those two will be adopted by consensus, and net payroll accounts of $72,696.32, and that will be received for information. A building report, and I see that when I look at some of the renovations and buildings that are going on, a single family dwelling, and some interior alterations and repairs to a couple of places, and damage to, I believe, the Sunrise Restoration is damaging or fixing the fire damage to Sunshine Cove. I believe that's what that one is, the second one. To the total of, for the month, of $760,000. And total to date, 2015, $6,008,050. And to date, in 2014, was $3,933,000. So we're pretty close to, you know, 50% more. So we're happy about that. Could we, that will just be received for information. Correct. And next we have... the CAO report. Do we have any committee reports? Anybody have committee reports? No.
I can give a quick update on the airport steering committee.
And you can either do it now or in your other report, in your later report.
I'll do report later.
Your report later? Okay, thank you. CAO, would you like to give your report?
Sure. Just a few of the activities that the administration has been involved in the last couple of weeks, starting in community services, where work is slowly proceeding on the shade structures for the splash park and the dog park. Staff is working on a community energy leadership program grant to offset the costs associated with some control environmental controls at the Sonora Center. They're also developing some new programs for January, including Zumba. In terms of corporate services, there's a completion of the bylaw enforcement and animal control services RFP, which closes on November 20th. Orientation of the deputy corporate officer continues, and an internal posting and processes for the for the replacement of the development secretary. In terms of finance, cemetery conversions to VADM system is about 75% complete. Budget preparation is well underway, and they attended a budget meeting with the Soyuz Rural Fire Department and the fire department. Planning and development. On November 12th, the tender was issued for Stage B of the Gyro Park Multipurpose Plaza with closure date of December 2nd. On November 3rd, CTQ consultants presented their findings to date at the public open house on the town's proposal for a public pier at the end of Gyro Park. On November 12th, the town hosted a housing workshop with representatives of local builders and realtors for input on a housing marketing plan for the town-owned Richter property. Public Works, Water Station 8 electrical project upgrades continues. 74th Avenue project continues the reconstruction with storm sewer drainage has been installed. The bike racks and cigarette butt catchers have been installed throughout the downtown area. Automated door locks will be installed at the public washrooms at Gyro and Goodman Parks on Saturday, November the 14th. And Rose Place cul-de-sac is scheduled to be repaved November 16th and 17th after installation of new Fortis underground power lines. Myself, I attended a municipal law seminar in Vancouver to finalize the contract for a town owner representative for the fire hall construction monitoring, attended the Gyro Pier open house, and continue working on business plan and budget reports.
Thank you very much. Do we need to accept?
As information.
Accept it, just receive it. Rhodes, Campbell, all in favor? Thank you. And councillor reports, Councillor Youngberg.
Thank you, Mayor McCordoff. Just an interesting couple of weeks trying to get used to the winter weather. But congratulations to the Coyotes. They've just been out and around the community. I've seen them working all over, volunteering their time, and patronizing different businesses. I just have to commend those young fellows. They're doing a great job for our community and certainly for the game of hockey. The Super Bowl fundraiser that I went to on Saturday was a great imagination that I understand came out of the East, and was an interesting concept, to say the least, where we picked our bowl and walked around and had a choice of 12 chefs preparing wonderful soups, and was a real interesting evening. And what a fundraiser for the Desert Sun Counseling. They raised, I'm sure, a lot of money and really did a great job. As did the Harvesting Diversity, a terrific collection of ethnic foods and participation in the community from all of the people who participated. Also, I have to congratulate three new businesses in town. We seem to have a couple of doors closed and a couple open, and that's always real invigorating from my point of view. And it's good to see Osuyas Nails and Osuyas Laser Clinic and the new Vapor House relocating on Main Street with a Pure Leader depot, which we really need. I think that's about my report for this week. Thank you.
Thank you. Councillor Rhodes.
Thank you, Mayor McCordoff. I wanted to mention that I attended the Remembrance Day ceremony last week, and of course I was on November 11th. And I just wanted to really shout out to this community and how well that thing was attended. It was absolutely phenomenal. Last year I thought we'd had our best crowd, but this year it was so crowded that the Osuyas Coyotes that were sitting in a couple of rows actually had to get up and let some of the residents sit down. I just can't say enough how meaningful that is to this community, and everybody that was there, way to go. It was just a great, great event for our community. And I also have a couple of things to mention about the Osuyas Museum Society. I attended their meeting on October 21st, and they're still actively involved in trying to engage the community so people will come forward and not only volunteer, but to sit on their board. So once again, if you're interested, you can get in touch with me anytime, and I'd be happy to hook you up with that board over there. Some of the things that they're going through right now are kind of interesting in our community. A lot of us will notice that there's been a lot of interpretive signage that's been popping up all over the place. Lots and lots of positive comments about it, and they are working on three of those right now. Some will be going down on the Pioneer walkway, and they're working hand in hand with the Osuyas Lake Quality Society to do some signage for them as well. And as well, they're gathering information for the Jack Shaw Garden, which is where the Splash Park is located as well. They wanted me to thank AG Foods for their financial contribution to the museum. $1,700 they collected, and that was based on some of their sales and some of the special items that they had over a weekend some time ago. So thank you very much for that. Anybody that was paying attention, the Osuyas Museum Society did have a thermometer up on the fence right beside the Osuyas Home Building Center, and that's been taken down, and I wanted everybody to know that it was taken down so that they can put it back up when it's a little bit more appropriate towards the, you know, as we move forward, and was not taken down because because of the crappy vandalism that happened to that sign. It was just deplorable. I mean, you know, graffiti is graffiti, and some can be accepted or not. That was just totally unacceptable, and some idiot, you know, put some terrible derogatory words in there that I'd really like to say right now today, but would not be appropriate. So, anyway, that will be going back up as we get closer to that. Good, positive meeting. The people that are there are well motivated, and they're looking forward to the next few years and working towards the various things that they have to do to occupy that building in the future. So that's my report.
Thank you very much. And Councillor Rhodes was talking about Remembrance Day. All of us were there, all of council, we all took part in the Remembrance Day ceremony. And I was speaking to a lady after at the over at the Cenotaph, and she was from Alberta. She's a snowbird. And she said that was the nicest Remembrance Day ceremony she'd ever been at. So I thought, what a nice thing to comment to all of the Legion. I did tell them down at the Legion that somebody had said that. And to Doc Ritchie for just taking a leadership in this, as he's done for many, many years, and for Stephen Hershey, who is the Padre. So it was a wonderful service, and I was particularly pleased that there were so many young people there, and I think that's a really good sign. So thank you for bringing that up. Councillor Campbell.
Thank you, Mayor McCordoff. And just to be repetitive there regarding the Remembrance Day, again, another day that just felt really good about being part of this community. And to the point Mayor McCordoff just made, I interact with snowbirds on a regular basis, and that was the feedback I heard, was that in a community this size, to see that kind of attendance and an event that well put together really said a lot about the community. It was very impressive. An update on the airport steering committee. As you're aware, we were looking between two firms to potentially hire to execute the study. This week on Tuesday and Friday through GoToMeeting, the committee will be interviewing both of those firms in order to make a decision in a timely manner. Just to let people know that the Festival of Trees, again, will be starting this year November 28th until January 2nd. So if you're a local business or a group of locals that want to sponsor a tree, it's for a great cause and to raise money for the BC Children's Hospital. And just to talk about the Coyotes for a second that are having another incredible season. But over and above that, what a night out at a Coyotes game has turned into is just seems to be getting better and better each year. And I mean, I'll give you an example. Over the last few weeks, I attended two different games that had local sponsors. I paid $10 for a ticket to go see the game and walked out with $20 worth of groceries. you know what? And the things, the activities that are happening on the ice in between periods, just an excellent place to take the family and for a night out. So kudos to the organization. And that's my report.
Thank you very much. Councillor King.
Thank you, Mayor McCordo. I guess it's a little bit repetitive, but I'd really like to thank the Suffolk County Chamber for the harvesting diversity with the capabilities of bringing five ethnic groups to the table for food and entertainment. It was just outstanding. Also attended the Desert Suns Soup Bowl fundraiser. Again, I'd like to really thank the Arts Council that partnered with them, that made the bowls, that actually helped make it happen. I'd like to thank the city staff for getting the bicycle racks up. I think that was very important and long time coming. And just a little reminder that December 4th is Christmas light up, and hope to see everybody in town downtown. Thank you. That's my report.
Thank you very much. And I've written down several things here, some of which have already sort of been mentioned. But speaking of the bike racks downtown, I was down there the other day, and there was a brand new bike rack there, and there was a bike 5 feet away, not attached to it. But I couldn't find out who the owner was, otherwise I would have said something. So please use the bike racks, that's what they're there for, and there are cigarette catchers down there as well. So one of the things that I wanted to talk about was shoeboxes. And this is the week that the shoeboxes are being collected. They're being collected over at the Azuis Baptist Church. And you can get boxes. boxes and fill them up, and there's all kinds of information about it, but I do believe you have to have it done by Friday of this week. I already took mine over there. If anybody has any shoe boxes or is interested in doing that for Samaritan's Purse, please think about it and get it done this week. There's also, I see in the paper, a pajama drive that Connie at Cactus Ridge is doing again, and she collects pajamas for young children and gives them out to School District 53, and they pass them out, and apparently it was been very successful the last 2 years, and they're doing it again. Christmas Light Up is a really important event. It's the 27th annual this year, and so there's several things on the Friday, December the 4th. Smitty's holds a pancake breakfast, first of all, breakfast with the Coyotes are all there helping out again, serving, plus a bunch of the Soroptimus. I will be there at 7 making coffee. And you get a free breakfast if you bring either a donation or a toy, unwrapped toy, and the Kiwanis and the Smitty's put this on with help from all kinds of groups in the community. So come and support that. On December the 4th at 6:30 will be the Light Up Parade, and we have encouraged downtown businesses to stay open a little bit later that night, sort of from between 5 and 7, so that you know, you can offer a special, and people that are lining up to watch the parade can go in and out of your businesses. There will be choirs downtown. The international choir led by Lloyd Fairweather will be outside Home Hardware. And the Asuyas Rotary is cooking hot dogs and cocoa across the street at Imperial Office Pro. So please come out and support that. And then after that, I believe there's a Coyotes game on you can go to, or there's Santa's Night Out at Sonora Center. So lots of things to do, and nobody can say that they're bored. The following day, there is Breakfast with Santa, and that's at the Baptist Church, and again, the Coyotes and the Suez Royalty, very involved with everything. They will be there, and then there is a craft fair at the Legion. And that's sponsored by the Asuyas Festival Society, but the Kiwanis look after that. So please come out and support these special events. And you will see a car in the parade with all members of council attending, because they have it on their calendar. And a couple of things that are on in town right now. There's lots of craft fairs. I was at the Elks Hall yesterday. They had a wonderful craft fair. I got some buns and some chocolates and some jelly was made by the local archery group. All kinds of things like that. I see that there's some on this weekend. There's also some on the following weekend and on Christmas weekend. So you can do your Christmas shopping locally by attending these craft fairs. And what surprises me, I was at the Empty Bowls fundraiser on Saturday night as well, and there are so many people in town, snowbirds, and you know what? They're all attending these things because several people I didn't know, and some of them came up and said to me that they were here, they'd read about it online, they'd read about it in the paper, and so they come here and they have fun. They absolutely enjoy all of the things that Asuyas has to offer. I did the ribbon cutting the other day at Fields. We're very happy to have that store in town. They offer, I think, a needed children and men's clothing, and I think that was one area that was probably needed in town. Lots of women's stores. We have lots of access to good quality clothing. So lots of things on for the next couple of weeks. Please come out and enjoy them all. Look on Asuyas Daily News, look on the town website, look in the Asuyas Times, and come out and support all these events, shop locally, and enjoy this cooler weather. So thank you very much to all of you, and we need a motion to adjourn. Thank you, Councillor King, Councillor Campbell, all in favor. Thank you very much.